We are back again for one final monumental presentation. Okay. We love Star Trek Online, and I want to thank StarTrek.com for putting this presentation together. Here to introduce our wonderful developers of Star Trek Online is our own Holly Otis from CBS Consumer Products, a great lady that's been helping us out in the development of our show this weekend. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Holly. Coming out here, girl. Thank you, my dear.
Good evening, captains. Well, my name is Holly Amos, and I am a product development coordinator at CBS Consumer Products, which is the division of CBS that actually licenses Cryptic Studios to create Star Trek Online. We will actually be having Chase Masterson and Denise Crosby join us later, but for now I'd like to introduce the developers, our senior developers. So if you could please help me welcome lead designer Al Rivera. Steve Ricossa, who is the executive producer, and Samuel Wall, who is the lead artist. Hi, guys.
Hey.
Oh, you're over here.
So I'm going to be over here. So for those people in the audience who may not have played the game before, can you guys give us a quick overview of Star Trek Online?
Sure. So Star Trek Online is a free-to-play MMO that takes place in 2410, about 30 years after Nemesis. It puts you in the role of a captain in the Star Trek universe. So you can go from the Klingons to the Federation to the Romulans and play any faction you want. By free-to-play, I mean 100% free-to-play from beginning to end. And by MMO, I mean massively multiplayer, which means you can play with your friends, with your family, or anyone you meet here at the con.
Fantastic. Well, I feel like the best way to get to know anybody who works within the Star Trek franchise is to learn what their favorite series is and their favorite episode. So, for each of you.
I'm going to jump in again.
Okay.
So, my favorite series by far is Deep Space Nine.
Oh!
There it is. I love the take on the Federation, less black and white, more gray zone. And that definitely ties into my favorite episode, Pale Moonlight. There it is again, where Captain Sisko has to make a really tough choice, a real moral dilemma on how to save the Alpha Quadrant, do it by breaking the tenets of the Federation in order to save potentially trillions of lives. One of my favorite lines from that episode was from Garrick. You may have saved the Alpha Quadrant, and all it cost was the life of one criminal, one Romulan senator, and the self-respect of one Starfleet captain. It was so good, so good.
That's an easy question. It has to be TOS. I mean, the yeah, the color, the future that show paints is just amazing. But my favorite episode has to be Spectre of the Gun because it is.
That's my least favorite episode.
Really? But the minimalistic set design works so great in that episode, and with just the character of the red backgrounds, it paints the picture of this violent rage that Captain Kirk and the rest of Starfleet have. So, and then at the end, it drives to Spock questioning Kirk about the humanity's desire for violence and how they had to suppress it. It's so good.
Okay.
Well, I grew up on Star Trek, so I grew up with TOS. But my favorite series is definitely Deep Space Nine. So I have to agree with Ricossa here. As far as, you know, I enjoyed it because of the serialized nature of the story as opposed to the episodic content that we saw before that. As far as my favorite episode, that's always a tough one. Pale Moonlight is fantastic. Yesterday's Enterprise is wonderful, but I'll just say, I'll narrow it down to two, and I'll say Sacrifice of Angels and The Visitor with Tony Todd as Jake Sisko.
That's a good one. All right, well, okay. That was surprising to me, your guys' favorites. So Star Trek Online has been in development for just over 7 years. What was the team's initial goals in making the connection between your game and one of the biggest sci-fi franchises in the world?
So the key is having you be in charge of your ship, getting that true captain experience. It's your ship, your crew, your adventures. We have 124 episodes in Star Trek Online, which is equal to any five seasons of any other series in Star Trek. We want to make sure that you feel like the Kirk, that you feel like the Picard of your own ship in your own adventure. We also wanted to make sure we capture that very positional, tall ship style combat that is so indicative of Star Trek. That is another thing that we really had to capture and something we think about all the time whenever we're developing. Being in charge of your own adventure and that awesome combat.
Oh, great. So there's 6 years. Yeah, there's about 6 years of storyline at this point right now, most of which has been focused on the Iconian War. Can one of you give us a brief overview of the story thus far?
Sure. So the Iconians have been involved from the beginning when we launched 5.5 years ago. They've always been puppet masters behind the scenes. They were pushing the Undine, Species 8472, to instigate the Federation and Klingon War of 2409. Then later, through the Legacy of Rhymeless expansion, you saw that the Tal Shiar were influenced by the Iconians. That's represented for the destruction of the Hobus Star and a lot of the experimentation that they were doing. You also saw the Alachi, the Shroomy people from the Enterprise episode Silent Enemy. They're kind of the soldiers of the Iconians. And also the Click-Clicks. You might remember them from Schisms, right? The little so they were, we call them the Solanae. Then more recently with Delta Rising, you saw the Vaudoir, who have been out of the game for 1,000 years. And all of a sudden they show up with the technology and the tools to almost wipe out the Quadrant if it wasn't for the new Alliance and the player captains themselves. And now, most recently, with Season 10, just flat-out war with the Iconians and their heralds.
So the Iconians have actually been mentioned in the franchise quite a few times, but they've never played a primary role. So what was it like bringing such a formidable opponent to the game?
So whenever we want to bring something new to Star Trek Online, we always go first to the show. And we watched them all. We planned the Iconians to be part of the Star Trek Online from the beginning. 7 years ago, it was part of the plan. So we wanted a new opponent, a nemesis, if you will, that would that was unique and something hadn't really been explored before on the show. So we watched all the episodes multiple times. And we considered several candidates, such as the Zenkethi, the Fekiri, even the Khan, and but inevitably we fell upon the Iconians. And the Iconians you mentioned, they've been mentioned a couple times in the show. I think one episode of TNG and one of
Contagion,
Deep Space Nine.
And Contagion. To the Death.
Yes, and on there we learn is that they were decimated from all the galaxy, you know, banded together and destroyed them from orbit. We know they have these viral probes. We know that they have this gateway technology, which is really dangerous. So dangerous that the Federation now has orders to destroy it on site if they ever find that technology. And we also know that they've been referred to as demons of air and darkness. So that's about all we really know about the Iconians from the show. But that was enough for us to build upon a mythos for them and build a history for them and a motivation for them with just enough mystery. And that was a great platform for us to work with.
Great. So, I mean, designing an ancient race must have had its challenges. So how what was most compelling about building the Iconians and their heralds?
I could spend the rest of the night just on the visual aesthetics of the Iconians because we spent so much time on it. But demons and air and darkness became the cornerstone for the visual design of the Iconians, and we built them out to be almost ethereal beings that had highly advanced technology that almost appeared magic-like in our game. To go up against an Iconian is no easy task because they're controlling gravity, summoning constructs to fight for them, and using their gateways to bamf around and manipulate the battlefield. The teams did a fantastic job putting the Iconian War together, and we're so proud of what we were able to put out for that.
Great. Story, like actually creating stories, can one of you talk about like the story creating process?
Sure. So we usually spend about 12 to 18 months developing our story content in advance. A good example was Delta Rising. We knew we wanted to get to the Delta Quadrant, but we didn't want to spend 70 years getting there. So in season 8, which was almost a year before, we introduced the Dyson Spheres, which would teleport or let people jump from one section of space to the other. So now players can go from the Alpha and Beta Quadrant to the Delta Quadrant. So now that we kind of had a way to get there, we had to find out how we were going to fill that story the rest of the way. So what we did was we sit down and we come up with our ideas, and everyone has their favorite moments, like, oh, this would be cool and that would be cool. And with those eventually coalesce into kind of episode chunks. And so we go, oh, this is kind of the beginning, this is kind of the middle, this is kind of the end. And then a little bit more refinement, and it comes down to, you know, a handful of episodes. Okay, we're gonna have 6 episodes go live before the expansion. And once we have them into those individual episodes and they're in a spot where they're refined enough that we feel like we can work with them, we'll sit down and everyone says, oh, who would be the best actor for this episode? Who would be the best actor for that episode? And once we have that figured out, then I'll look at the budget and I'll go talk with Al, and then he'll start contacting celebrities and see who we can get and who's available to fill those roles.
So how do you go about integrating the characters, new voice actors into the game?
So it actually happens at the conventions, like here at Star Trek Las Vegas. This gives us an opportunity to meet and interact with them and reach out to them and build a relationship. So we we can contact them and see if they're interested in actually working with us. Then as we're developing the story framework, like Steven said, we will try to find like where we need to go and where's a good place that we could add one of the characters. And but we don't just want to just throw a character into any old episode just for them to just be there shooting with you and just be eye candy. We want to make sure that the stories we build are personal to those characters. Perhaps those characters have threads that have been, story threads that haven't been finished or something that is really personal to them that's happened to them. So that's really the cornerstone of how we do that, and so we never just throw one in there. So that's the main part of the process, is making sure that it is it's meaningful to have that character there.
What are some of your favorite stories involving celebrities?
Mine has to be when Michael Dorn reprised his role as Worf. And in his featured episode, Sphere of Influence, you're traversing through this strange, dark, creepy alien environment, and you come across the table from Schisms. And to get that table in-game was no easy task or undertaking. The artist that was working on this featured episode, he wanted to improve on what you saw from the show. And after a few meetings, conversations, and making him watch the episode at least like 6 times, he saw the importance of it and got it in-game. But it all paid off when a YouTuber recorded their experience and totally flipped out when they saw the table and recognized it instantly, and it's just like, I know what's going on. And just, he loved the tie-in that we had for the character of Worf from Schisms, and seeing that all the story build-up that we did. And so, but now that artist is probably one of our biggest advocates to making sure that the art is show accurate.
Well, that's always important. Either one of you have any fun stories?
Sure. I'll go next. I would say probably my favorite moment is from a featured episode in the game called Dust to Dust. And Dust to Dust is a continuation of actually 2 Voyager episodes. One, Deadlock, where Harry Kim actually dies. So if everyone remembers, Harry Kim in the show is not the original Harry Kim. He's a quantum duplicate. The original Harry Kim died in like season 1, I think it was. Ricossa is telling me it's 2, so okay. the other one is Ashes to Ashes, which is where we introduce to the Kabali, we learn that the Kabali reproduce by reanimating the dead of other species. So in our featured episode, Dust to Dust, a continuation of that, the Kabali finds Ensign Kim's body in space and reanimate it, and so he's turning into a Kabali. But things go really bad, he freaks out, he doesn't realize it's 30 years later. So you're called in along with Captain Harry Kim to kind of clean up the situation. And in that episode, Garrett Wong just gives an amazing performance, because he plays as both an older Captain Kim and a younger, frightened Ensign Harry Kim who's turning into a Kabali. And he doesn't understand it, and so Captain Kim is furious that this happened, and Ensign Kim is panicking, and he's mad. He's, you stole my life. It's been, you know, what I was supposed to get home, not you. You stole my life. Where's Janeway? Where's Mom? Where, you know, where's my girlfriend? And it's a really gut-wrenching moment, and it's just beautifully played by Garrett. And so it's really my favorite moment in the game involving one of the primary actors.
That's a great story.
So one of my favorite moments was from the Delta Rising expansion. It was from the fourth episode, and Seven of Nine, it's her first mission with you, and you beam down to a planet of Turei, and they're under attack, and to you, it's an unknown enemy. And you come across a field of injured or dead Turei, and you find one, and you revive him. And she says, what happened here? Who's attacking you? And he says, you're Seven of Nine. This is your fault. This is the Vaudoir. You're the one who woke them up. And they're punishing us for being involved in their destruction 1,000 years ago. And it was such a powerful moment for that character. And boy, Jeri Ryan just killed it. She did so great in that role. It's funny, everyone on the dev team, typically when we have someone record, sometimes they come in house and sometimes we record from whatever their local studio is, but the audio team always pipes it into their office so they can hear it all and record it properly. And we'll always go over and sneak a listen, right, just to hear them do their role again. And at one point, Ethan Phillips was in the booth and he was reprising Neelix and he was absolutely killing it. And so I had a few minutes to pop over there and I snuck over and there was already a couple people there listening, which was funny. And he'd lived with Alpha Quadrant people for a very long time, but there's many species he hadn't met. And so he's recording a line for when a Romulan player comes to the Tlaxian asteroid base for the first time. And he goes, ooh, Romulans. And I was like, man, Ethan Phillips is just killing it. He loved it. He hadn't been Neelix in 15 years, and he was just right in there. It was really cool.
So for those people who might not have played, where does the Iconian War leave us?
The Iconian War. Well, it's next week we will have the next episode of Butterfly. We'll be releasing that next week. The player will be going back to the Krennim. They're getting desperate. And about a month after that, we will be releasing our finale of the Iconian War, and it will be an epic battle for the galaxy, right? And it's going to have a very spectacular ending that I hope everyone will enjoy. So after that, we will be launching a brand new story arc. Okay, it's a story arc that will take the player through 2016 and beyond. So it's really a great time to join Star Trek Online right now because you'll be able to get into a brand new story from the ground floor. It's a story about rebuilding, right? Rebuilding from the war. It's a story where we'll be introduced to a new enemy, one that we've seen in Star Trek, but never in Star Trek Online. We get to witness their origin story, if that makes sense. It's also about how the Federation, the Klingons, will be dealing with these temporal technologies that they've been playing with. It's a brand new story. It's a new beginning. It's a new era. So we'll be talking today. We're announcing season 11, Star Trek Online, New Dawn.
The Iconian War. So many people. So many ships. So many worlds. Gone. But we fought back. We made the hard choices. We triumphed. Now, it's time to be explorers again. We belong out on the final frontier, making contact with distant worlds and finding a new tomorrow. There's an entire galaxy out there waiting for us. Remember, Captain, when the technology doesn't yet exist, when the mystery can't be solved, when the odds are unbeatable, that's when they call for Starfleet. Your journey into the final frontier is just beginning.
That's a pretty awesome trailer, I have to say.
I know, I'm like getting emotional about it. So what sort of features will be playing in New Dawn?
So as Elle said, we're going to be covering a brand new story that kind of covers the time travel aspects that were introduced, and you'll get more of in the next week's episode and the episode following that, the fallout from all of that. But we're starting a brand new story that will take us through 2016. So it's really a great time if you, for some reason, are in this room and never played STO before and are wondering if you should play. Now is a fantastic time. You have all the previous story to catch up on, and you can have the brand new story with the other players at the exact same time. Then we're going to kind of have a side story that's going to cover the fallout from the war from a different perspective. It's going to take place at Deep Space Nine and the Badlands, and the Mirror Universe also had an Iconian War. And they may have won, they may have lost, but however it goes, it's not going to have great consequences for our Prime Universe. And so we're going to kind of figure out what happened with them and how it affects us.
All right, and as far as for the features are concerned, we will have a couple new cues. These cues are going to be around Deep Space Nine. So the Mirror Universe is tied in with Deep Space Nine, as we know from the show. So it'll be cues around Deep Space Nine and inside Deep Space Nine. We're also going to be introducing a new space battle zone. The space battle zone is going to take place in the Badlands. And the Mirror Universe have set up a beachhead in there. And so that's where they'll be set up. And so there'll be a huge battle zone happening there. And then we also will be having a new feature, a new system called the Admiralty System. Now, I'm not going to get into too much detail here about it today, but the Admiralty System will be very similar to Duty Officer System, but it'll be using your starships. So you'll be able to send your starships out onto campaigns and tours of duty to collect rewards for you. So the more ships you have, the more campaigns you're going to be able to engage in. And so you'll be able to put to use some of the older ships and smaller ships. They'll have a really important role, so you'll be able to use them as well. So they'll always have value. So we'll talk more about that soon in the coming days.
So I want to know about the art, because this theme is going to be more hopeful. What was it like building the art for this? How are you tackling that?
Well, it's a new story, a new beginning, a new dawn. So we're bringing back color to Star Trek Online through the Iconian War. It was dark, depressing, hopeless. So as you can see, there's the bright blue sun, and it's just an amazing way to kick off the season. It's a great system map to fly around in, but we're revamping the Badlands and doing a few things at DS9. It's just, we're really excited for you guys to get in there and play and see the amazing art that the art team's doing. And they're always pushing the envelope to improve the quality bar and always raising it higher.
Clap about everything. Yeah. So we've seen some familiar faces in Star Trek Online, so who can we expect to see at the end of the Iconian War and into New Dawn?
Yes. So what we have is in the upcoming episode, we have Aron Eisenberg joining us as Captain Nog. He will be in the next episode, and he'll also be joined by Jeri Ryan. And in our finale, we'll be bringing back several favorites, including, again, Aron and Robbie McNeil and Garrett Wong, and as well as a special appearance. Bye. And here he is, Aron Eisenberg. Aron, thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. I'm going to sit way over here. I'm going to balance this out. I don't know what you guys are doing. You're all on one. It's like it's going to tip over.
There's too many couches.
See, you should have been here. Maybe two and then one. This is so
we like to be cozy. Excellent. That's much better.
I'll sit like this. Is this comfortable? So awkward. I'm so creepy.
And then after the Iconian War, we'll have season 11, where we'll be joined by Chase Masterson. Now, Chase Masterson has worked in the game before. She's come in as Leeta, but she's actually going to be joining us as Mirror Leeta. She will be the fleet admiral leading the forces of the Terran Empire against the Federation. There she is. Please welcome Ms. Chase Masterson.
Do we have the news?
Hi, guys.
Okay.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you for being in the game. We
thank
have
you.
One more surprise for you today. In the finale of the Iconian War, we have a special Iconian appearance by our Denise Crosby as Sela, and she decided to stop by today. I believe she's here. Do we have Denise
Maybe,
Crosby?
Possibly. Yay!
Yes, she is.
Thank you.
Thank you, Denise, for joining us at the last minute and stopping by.
Listen, I love this game. I love what you guys are doing. I love what you have, where you've taken the character of Sela and done. You've done on the game what I was always hoping that the TV show would do. So I finally got it.
So I want to ask them some questions now. I'm gonna.
That's so rude how you turned your back to them like that.
Why am I sitting here? Like, this is a weird. Now that you point out this is awkward, this is awkward. So, Aron, what was it like seeing your character in game?
Oh well, seeing it finally was great. Doing the voiceover was a lot of fun. Luckily, I still have my teeth, so I was able to at least recreate the voice as good as I can. And it was a blast to do. It was a lot more than I expected, because it was really the first time I did a true voiceover. So it was a lot more in the script than I thought. And I wish I looked at it ahead of time, but now I'm glad I didn't, because I think it went really well. So now if I ever do it again, I don't want to look at the script, but then I don't know if I should look at the script. It's very neurotic. It's a very neurotic process. I'm just going to go off stage now.
Chase, I wanted to ask you, you are going to be coming back, like he mentioned, as Mirror Leeta. So are you looking forward to exploring more of that character?
I am so looking forward to it. And I'm looking forward to you guys exploring that character. It's so funny. Of all the episodes I did, I think I get asked about the Mirror Universe episode the most. And I think it's partly because Leeta turns into such a badass, and partly because there's other provocative things in that character in that episode. But I think mostly it's just a fun turn, a very adventuresome turn on someone who is ordinarily very gentle. And I think we can probably all relate to that. So it's going to be really fun bringing her back.
I'm excited. I also wanted to ask you quickly about your anti-bullying campaign.
Thank you.
Just to get a little bit off topic, sorry.
Thanks.
And your involvement with the UN. If you wanted to talk about that a little bit.
Thanks, I'll tell you guys right quick. 2 years ago, I founded the Pop Culture Anti-Bullying Coalition, which is, thanks. Thank you so much. Have you guys heard about it? Okay, well, it basically is the first ever organization to make a stand against bullying, racism, misogyny, and other forms of hate at a Comic-Con. And I did it because I realized that there had never been an outreach against those things and for real-life heroism. We celebrate these stories on screen, and they're fantastic stories, and the reason we love them so much is because this is the way that we're supposed to live. And so I founded this organization with two anti-bullying experts, and we've done 9 convention appearances, and my partners, the experts, go and work in schools, and I've also done work with them in communities to make the world a better place and to bring IDIC into the real world, because that's the way the world is supposed to be. It's working. Celebrating and leading in heroism in both everyday and extraordinary ways. And thanks to you guys are the ones that started all this and that really understand that these stories are foundational to how we're meant to live. So that's what we're trying to do. Oh, and the United Nations Association is one of our partners. We partnered with the UN Association, the No Hate Campaign, and the Anti-Defamation League. And this year, because of the work we've been doing for the last 2 years, the United Nations Association asked me to be on their advisory board. So there's that.
Great. Well, thank you guys for giving us a sneak peek at a new dawn. We're actually going to open up the floor to questions.
Well, actually, I have a real quick question for Denise.
Oh, okay. Ask away.
So, I know we can't really talk about it too much, but we talked last night in detail about your story, right? About what you'll be doing. And you've been working with us for a couple years now. I was just wondering how you felt about the transition of the characters and where it's going, and what's and because you actually even played Tasha Yar in an episode at one point, if you remember, that was a while ago. So what do you think about where we're going with the story? And because I remember the first time I met you, you were like, I'm going to be in Star Trek Online, and Tasha Yar is going to save the universe or something like that.
Really? You know, I just again the story arc that you have for Sela is very much along the lines of how I envisioned it would go with Sela in the Next Generation. There was always an intent, you know, I was the one who came to the producers after yesterday's Enterprise, which allowed Tasha to be alive again, with the idea of Sela. I thought that, you know, it was a little bit different, that she would have, that Tasha would have a daughter with Lieutenant Castillo. That was my original, you know, sort of vision of her. But they changed it so that she would have this Romulan, half-Romulan daughter. But I always wanted, the through line was always that Sela would have to come to understand her human side and somehow get to know her mother truly for what she was and the Federation and go through an incredible change by embracing that. So you guys have allowed, without going into the detail of what is about to take place, you are on the same track as I am. So it's good. You know, we found each other. We can make that happen.
Excellent. We're very, very happy to have you joining us and being such a big part of Star Trek Online. So thank you so much for all the hard work you've done over the years.
It was my pleasure. I'm going to have to go right now because I have a photo op. But I just...
Thank you so much for stopping by.
I really wanted to thank you for all the work, incredible work you guys do. Excited for you guys to join in. And please tell your friends, play the game. I look forward to all of your feedback next time I see you.
Thank you, Denise.
Oh, gentlemen, you may sit.
Oh,
okay, that was a nice treat.
Now we can open the floor to questions. There's people. So let's start over here.
What you got there?
Hi, my name is Robert. I'm here with my friend Clinton. But we play Star Trek Online. We've been playing for years.
Excellent.
I am a fleet commanding officer of Special Operations Command. And we also have the House of Calafia, a Klingon fleet, and then a SOCOM Delta, which is our secondary fleet.
Fantastic. Are you in an armada now?
We formed an armada, yes. It's growing. We have some room, and of course, it's a learning process, as you guys know. But to make this short, our fleet put together a token, if you will, our way of saying thank you for everything you guys do.
Oh, my goodness.
For those that haven't played Star Trek Online, it is a fantastic game. We've had a chance to meet... people from all over the world. He is not the first person I've met that's played Star Trek Online that lives far from where I live. So it's our way of saying thank you. Would like to give this to you.
No,
guys.
Thank you. Oh my God, what an honor. Thank you so much. Come here. Come on up.
It's a cricket.
Unbelievable. What? How unexpected. That's such a nice tribute. You know, it's. Well, let me see what you got there. Holy moly.
It's basically our fleet patches, which we have made.
You designed all these fleet patches.
They've been designed. We run around them with our fleet emblems. And yeah, like I said, it's...
This is unbelievable. This is going to go center stage in our office. I promise you. We will send pictures out. Are you coming to the Meet the Devs?
Yes.
Okay. What have you got here?
Photo book.
We also made a photo book.
Oh, my God, guys. This is...
My voice is gone from karaoke.
Yeah.
I made a photo book. We had everybody in our fleet as possible send us screenshots, and through Shutterfly, we made a photo book covering a bit of our history of our fleet.
And includes our fleet roster.
Did everybody hear that?
This is beyond, above, and beyond. Thank you, guys.
I am truly honored and blessed, and this is why we make this game. You know, we work in this game for 7 years, and people are passionate about it, and sometimes they get grumpy about it because they really want, there's things that they want from the game. But when we come here, we see the fans and we see their faces, and this is above and beyond. This is magnificent, and thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And I hope to see you
tonight, and we'll talk some more at 7:30. Okay, thank you.
I'm glad I started on that side of the stage. Over here,
thank
we
you.
Have a question.
Yeah, but now we have to follow it.
Don't worry, I've got that covered.
What did you guys bring?
What did you bring?
Hi, my name is Fox Anderson. By the way, Aron, Chase, nice to see you two again.
Hi.
So, on Star Trek Online, my character is Telkar at Wild Fox, and I'm a lead fleet admiral of Epsilon. We've already started our own armada and everything, and to give you a bit of history, I've not only a lead fleet admiral for Fleet Online, for the second fleet now, but also I'm a lifetime member slash career officer for those in the game that know the title, and complete with pre-order pack. So. I've been around for a while and know the game pretty much inside and out. I'm kind of the numbers guy for my fleet. But I was wondering, as like, what kind of impact and stuff are the is the Admiralty missions, the ship version of the duty officer missions, going to have on the for us as a player?
Do you want to take that or want me to take that?
You said duty.
Yes, D-U-T-Y.
Oh, okay.
Duty. So you want to know what kind of rewards or specifically from the Admiralty system?
Well, in the duty officer system and stuff, you can slot different duty officers and stuff for space and ground, and they'll actually impact mm-hmm. your build.
Oh, okay.
And how they do.
The active rosters.
Yeah, the active rosters and stuff. And
the Admiralty system will not have an active roster system. It's not exactly like the duty officer system. But there are campaigns, which are basically regions. Like there might be a Federation campaign and a Romulan campaign and Klingon campaign. Maybe in the future there'll be additional ones. But there'll be tours of duty, and as you complete tours of duty, those take a long time to complete. Well, the closest thing I could say, they're like assignment chains in the duty officer system, but they're not quite the same. But that's just the closest analogy for now. As you complete those will bring you large-scale rewards that are repeatable, and you can keep doing that. I won't get into details of the rewards, but to answer your question directly, no, there's no active roster for them. But what there are is that if you have big ships and you have little ships, they all have value within this system. So I promise you there'll be more details in the weeks to come. It's just a little too soon to talk about details today. We just want to give a high overview at this point.
In general, it's to make you feel like an admiral, right? You're commanding your ships that you're not flying still.
Cool. That's actually makes me rather glad that I hung on to over 30 ships.
Excellent. Thank you.
Makes us even more glad. Thank you.
I think we have time for one, maybe two more questions over here.
So I didn't bring a gift with me, but I was just wondering, since you're getting more and more of the old cast into Star Trek Online, do you feel like that's opening the door to new playable races outside of the Romulans?
You mean for like a new expansion?
Yeah.
Always. That's something that we've thought about. We have a couple of heavy hitters. I think we did a poll not too long ago. I would definitely say it's something that we've thought about, but it would be on the long-term horizon for sure.
Okay.
Tell me, who would you want to be a new playable faction? What would you want?
Something like Cardassian Dominion.
Something like Cardassians? Or Cardassians? Okay.
Cardassian Dominion is what he said, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
Interesting. It's a very DS9 heavy crowd. I like it. Yeah. I like it a lot.
Well, the DS9 cast is here. I feel like I have to say it.
Oh. Well, you can play a Ferengi. What more would you want to do? I mean, come on.
Exactly.
Sit down. Just go sit down.
It's a tough call, I know.
You just got your life membership revoked.
I'm sorry. Go on. It is a DS9 heavy season.
What kind
season,
of people are around here? This is ridiculous. What kind of fans are coming out here? Who is that guy?
Do we have time for one more?
Yeah, we have time for one more over here.
All right. I'm not sure we have the time to completely fill this out. In the past, we had a diplomatic path, and there were diplomatic missions, and they disappeared. Now, with the war over, are you going to bring them back for season 11?
They definitely won't be back for season 11, but it's something that we can get back to at another time.
That was a diplomatic answer.
It was. I guess that is a diplomatic system. Plus five diplomacy XP for me. But yes, it is something that we can consider moving forward in the future, but not for season 11.
All right.
Just go play a Ferengi. Sit down.
Team Ferengi. Well,
I'm so embarrassed, my son. I'll try to calm him down.
No, I'm wearing a watch on purpose.
You guys have time to stick around? 2 minutes. You got 1 minute. One more.
All right.
Thank you. Two quick questions, please. The gateway and the mobile, any progress on that? And secondly, any update on accolades, maybe to make them a little easier to search and possibly a reward for earning so many of them?
No, just go play a Ferengi. Sorry, I couldn't resist.
Currently, no plans to expand the gateway functionality, but we have had some talks about improving accolades, and it's a system that we'd like to get to potentially over the next year to 18 months, just to make it easier to search and easier to keep track of everything that you've earned.
Thank you.
And go play Ferengi.
Is it okay if I end the panel now, Aron?
If you play a Ferengi, yes, go play a Ferengi.
7:30 at the iBar. We're all going to be there.
Are you making a cut on this, Aron? Do you make a percentage or something on when they play a Ferengi?
No, it's just, you know, Ferengi are awesome, right? Thank you very much. Thank you. See that guy right there? Give him a free lifetime membership.
Some things
just
never
kidding.
Change. Oh, well.
Don't be jealous now. Don't be jealous. Ferengi are
that's
awesome.
That's what it is.
For those of you who were standing in line and didn't get to ask your question, the developers are actually going to be at the iBar at 7:30, so you guys can come down and ask them face-to-face.
Not just us, plenty more. Four or five others.
Thank you, guys, and thank you, Aron and Chase,
for
being
thank you
here.
For playing the game. I hope you continue to and enjoy it, and thank you for having me be part of the game.
Thank you
Thanks
so much
for
joining
the game,
us,
guys.
Aron
this is fun. Thanks so much for having us.